Welcome to Season 5 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore, Maryland. Our goal with this podcast is to bring scientific evidence and experience to shed light on critical health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call, and today Stephanie Desmon talks to Ziyad Al-Aly, director of the Clinical Epidemiology Center at Washington University in St. Louis. They discuss COVID-19 and the heart, including his recent study, which found a significant risk of heart problems in people a year after being diagnosed with COVID. Let's listen.
Ziyad Al-Aly, thanks so much for joining me.
Well, thank you for having me. Delighted to be with you.
So today we want to talk about COVID and the heart. So we've known for a while that people with COVID can develop heart issues like clots and inflammation and arrhythmia. You just published a new study that says that in some people, these symptoms can persist for a year or more. So what does this mean and what did you study?
So we've known for a while that COVID-19 in the acute phase, in the first 30 days, especially in people who really need to be admitted to the hospital, who had severe disease and need to be admitted to the hospital or need to be in the ICU, you know, they may develop complications and some of them could be heart complications. But what we didn't really know is that what happened to people's heart in the long term, what happens to people's heart, you know, 6 months out and even a year out. And most importantly, what happens to people who had mild disease and did not need to be hospitalized, did not need to go into the hospital, and did not need ICU care. So we did this study to, you know, evaluate the long-term risk, so to speak, the one-year risk of heart problems in people who got COVID-19 compared to nearly 11 million controls of people who did not get COVID-19. And then use sort of statistical methods to balance the arms, or kind of, you can think of it like even the playing field, so that the only difference is that the people assigned to the COVID-19 arm were actually had COVID-19, and the people who are in the control, you know, had similar characteristics, but absolutely no COVID-19. And you know, evaluated them for about a year to determine what's the risk of heart problems from COVID-19 itself.
Mm-hmm. And what did you find?
So the major findings were that people with COVID-19 have a higher risk of all sorts of heart problems at 1 year, and that included arrhythmias of the heart, sort of like irregular heartbeats. The heart could be beating too fast or too slow. You know, something called atrial fibrillation, which is really a fast heart rhythm, so like in a particular pattern. We found evidence of increased risk of strokes, increased risk of blood clots in the legs, something we call DVT, that's blood clots in the legs, increased risk of blood clots in the lungs, increased risk of heart failure and heart attacks. There was really increased risk of a broad spectrum of heart problems, ranging from, you know, how the heart beats and whether it beats too fast or too slow or irregular heartbeats, to, you know, blood clots, to myocardial infarction or heart attacks, to, you know, heart failure. And, you know, the risk was evident. You know, I went into it thinking that the risk was going to be most pronounced or really most evident in people who maybe smoked a lot, had diabetes or heart disease to start with, or had kidney disease, or, you know, had some risk factors. But what we really found is that even in people who did not have any heart problems to start with, zero heart problems to start with, were athletic, did not have a high BMI, did not have obesity, did not smoke, did not have any kidney disease, did not have diabetes, even in those people who were really previously healthy and had no risk factors or no problems with the heart, even in those people that had, you know, COVID-19 affected them in such a way that they actually had a manifested higher risk of heart problems than you know, people who did not get COVID-19.
It's remarkable.
Yes, and I think what's sort of also really eye-opening here, that the risk was also evident even in people who did not have severe COVID-19 that necessitated hospitalization or ICU care, meaning that the people who got COVID-19 and maybe were asymptomatic, or maybe got COVID-19 that was so mild that they were able to nurse it at home and take care of it at home and did not need to go to the doctor for it, did not need to go to the hospital for it, did not need to be admitted or taken care of in the ICU for it. Even in those people who had mild and sometimes asymptomatic or, you know, without symptoms COVID-19, they actually went on to still develop an increased risk of heart problems even a year out.
So what's going on in the body, do we think?
So we think there's a lot of different things that could be happening. It's possible that the, you know, virus itself and the immune reaction to it or immune response to it sort of result in a, you know, intense inflammation that then subsequently hits the heart and results in some of the manifestations that we're seeing here. It's possible that COVID-19 may attack, and there's actually quite a bit of evidence so far, may attack the lining of the vessels, something called endothelial cells, sort of are the cells that line the vessels of the heart and other vessels. And when it attacks them, it makes them sort of sick, and some of them might die and eventually sort of facilitate the forming of blood clots and forming of blockages of the arteries of the heart or the vessels of the heart. There are several, you know, other mechanisms that revolve around something called the ACE receptor. Now, the ACE receptor is really important because the virus has something called a spike protein. And the spike protein, you can think of it as almost like the key that engages a lock. It's called the ACE receptor. And it kind of like is able to, you know, facilitate, once it engages that receptor, it then may facilitate entry of the virus into cells, including heart cells. So you can think of it as almost like the virus, luck would have it, that the virus has the keys to the human cells. And it turns out that the ACE receptor is evident or is present on a lot of cell types, including heart cells. So there are a lot of mechanisms that might explain why this is really happening in people's heart. Why would SARS-CoV-2, you know, the virus that causes COVID-19, which we all thought about as a respiratory virus, why would it attack the heart and also so many, you know, months down the road, up to a year down the road? And that's sort of like likely one of the explanations.
So now this study was done in a population before vaccination was widely available. Are any indication that, for example, breakthrough infections would have a different result long-term?
Yes. So we are doing this and we will definitely share the results whenever we're able to share them, you know, widely and publicly. But it's very important to contextualize this. You're absolutely correct that this study was done in an era before the vaccines were widely available in the US, and which actually in our study meant that more than 99% of patients did not receive the vaccine before they got COVID-19. Actually, less than 1% got the vaccine before they got COVID-19. So almost universally, like more than 99% of the patients in our cohort, in our study, did not get the vaccine before they got COVID-19. Now, the question is, you know, in people who got the vaccine and then subsequently got breakthrough infection, like you're suggesting, you know, does the risk of heart problems, is the risk of heart problems really less? And I think the jury is still out, you know, and we certainly are very interested in addressing this, and we will share publicly as soon as we can.
Great. So the population you studied was Veterans Administration records, and those are mostly men, mostly white, mostly older. And so my question is, do you feel as though this applies to the entire population?
Yes and no. I think we always have to be sort of cognizant that this study comes from one system, you know, the VA system, but it also need to put it in the larger context that this is nearly a study of more than 11 million people. And people tell me like, oh my God, most of the vets are males. It's true, but 10% of the vets are females, which make it that our study has more than 1 million female. And it, arguably, you know, it's not a small number of people to study for COVID-19. I mean, you know, even if we only took the female out and then studied only in female, we still have 1 million people, and it would still be the largest study to date on heart problems in COVID-19. And then similarly for Black participants, you know, people say, oh, well, like majority of your guys are white, but it's 20% Black participants, which would mean more than 2 million people. So I think because it's so vague, I think it's sort of it's important to realize that that's a limitation, and it's important to sort of contextualize it as such and interpret it as such, but not to really be too carried away to say like, oh my God, you know, like we don't know what happens with women because this is a study of mainly males. And then in addition to this, we actually did subgroup analyses to see like what would happen in only women or only men or only people, you know, Black people or, you know, or white people or people who are younger than certain age and older than certain age. And across the board, we saw increased signal, meaning increased risk of heart problems, you know, across the board, across these subgroups, telling us that it didn't matter if you were like a female or male, if you're a black person or a white person, if you were like older or younger, it didn't matter if you had diabetes or didn't, if you smoke or you didn't, if you had, you know, chronic kidney disease or you didn't, if you had other, you know, cardiovascular risk factors or you didn't. And there was really a risk across the board. And so that was driven by COVID-19. It's kind of like, you can think of it as like, it really spared no one and it really affected even younger individuals with no smoking, no obesity, no heart problems, no diabetes. Even in those people, there was a significantly higher risk of cardiovascular problems a year out.
So we've heard a lot about long COVID, and we sort of still, you know, the jury's out on all of the different things that that might encompass. Obviously, this would fit into that category.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. So long COVID is really the umbrella term that describes all the post-acute manifestations that happens in a person, you know, like that are the result of COVID-19, and it happens in the post-acute phase. And it could be things that started in the acute phase and then lingered on and then persisted beyond the acute phase and, you know, went into sort of like a long term. Or it could be things that are new that happened, you know, 3, 4, 5 months out that could be attributable to SARS-CoV-2. And then that, when you take that definition in mind, you know, it's very, very clear to me that, you know, heart manifestations or the heart manifestation that we describe in our report are part and parcel of the broader picture of long COVID. So long COVID is this umbrella term that can, you know, give you certainly fatigue and brain fog, but it can also result in heart problems. It can result in new onset diabetes and kidney problems. And all of that collectively really form the multi-layered, multifaceted long COVID. Long COVID isn't really one thing. It's not only brain fog or fatigue. It's really more than one thing. And it's really multiple manifestations that are sort of formed collectively, you know, what we call as long COVID. Now, that's not to say for the people who are listening to this, not to say that, you know, one patient will have all of these things. We're not saying that, you know, but I think in defining the term and trying to understand what long COVID is, it's really an umbrella term for all the things that can happen as a result of the viral infection and that can persist beyond the acute phase of the infection.
So we're going to have a lot of people when this is said and done who have some form of long COVID and they're going to be chronically ill, right? It's going to be a real strain on government resources and all that sort of thing. What do you see as the future here?
Well, that's really why talking about it is very, 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 very important. So we think long COVID can affect anywhere between 4% and 7% of people. And people say, oh, these are single digit percentages, you know, 4% and 7%, single digit, that's really small. It is not, if you really multiply that number by the huge number of people who got infected with COVID in the United States, you know, more than 80 million people, and it's still counting, it's still, you know, more and more people infected by the day. So we think that that really will translate into millions of people with long COVID in need of care. And I think, you know, broadly speaking, our systems need to be prepared. Our health systems, you know, people are running health systems or running clinics and, you know, and listening to this, they definitely need to be, when we start preparing for the tide of patients that are going to hit our doors with heart problems and other long COVID problems. And on a government level, I think we definitely, you know, need to be prepared for this. We cannot sort of move on from the pandemic and disregard its long-term consequences. You know, arguably the long-term consequences are going to even be more profound and really will stick with us and will scar a lot of our people around us, you know, for generations, you know, some for their lifetime. I think what's really different about, you know, the manifestations that we're describing in this report is that a lot of them are chronic conditions that will last with people for a lifetime. For example, when we talk about heart failure isn't something that, you know, you wake up tomorrow and all of a sudden you don't have heart failure. It's not how it works. When people have heart failure, very, very likely they would have heart failure for life. So those are now chronic conditions that are not, we're no longer talking about things that might improve tomorrow. You can think maybe somebody has fatigue or weakness, but you can think they may actually get, you know, some, you know, treatment, et cetera, and then maybe in a week or two regain their energy, right? I mean, you see stories like that where people sort of like, you know, bouncing back and regaining that energy, you know, because these are maybe a generally reversible symptoms or reversible condition, fatigue, right? You know, obviously some people can have chronic fatigue and that can affect them for a lifetime. I'm not saying that doesn't exist. Absolutely, it exists. But I think when we, you know, we're seeing in heart disease, we're seeing things that are really chronic conditions that would scar people for a lifetime. And those things require certainly care for a long, long, long time horizon. I think people, you know, health systems and governments need to be prepared for this.
Ziyad Al-Aly, thank you so much for joining me.
Well, thank you very much for having me. I enjoyed talking to you. Thank you.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmon. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker, Matthew Martin, Spencer Greer, and Holly Cardinale, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media support from Grace Holds Fernandez. Thank you for listening.